Welcome back. We were discussing the laws of large numbers. In particular, for IID random variables, we said that the weak law of large numbers says that the sample average converges in probability to expectation of x. And similarly, the strong law of large number says that the same sample average converges to expectation of x almost surely, right. So, these two results we will prove today. Okay. Strong law of large numbers we will not prove in full generality because it is a fairly long proof. We will prove it for with slightly more additional assumptions. Okay. So, first we will do the weak law of large numbers. So, if you remember you have, so xi are IID random variables with expectation of x finite, then we have to show. So, we have to show that this average converges to expectation of x in probability, right. So, there is actually let me do two proofs. Okay. So, one of them is a very simple proof which assumes finite variance. Okay. So, the theorem itself does not assume anything other than finite mean, right. But if you assume in addition that the variance is finite, the proof is very easy. Okay. Again, the theorem does not require finite variance, okay, but the proof is easy if you assume finite variance. So, partial proof. So, if you assume sigma x square is finite, in this case it so turns out that you can prove mean square convergence very easily. Okay. So, in particular, so this is S n over n, right. So, we have expectation of S n over n is equal to expectation of x, right, because expectation of S n is nothing but n times the expectation of x. So, this you will agree, right. So, what I am claiming is I will be able to prove the mean square convergence of S n over n to expectation of x, and since mean square convergence implies convergence in probability, I will be done, right. So, you consider expectation of S n over n minus expectation of x square. Okay. So, I want to claim, so if I prove this limit goes to 0 as n tends to infinity, I would have proved mean square convergence, correct. Now, this is S n over n minus expectation of S n over n, right. So, this is nothing but the variance of S n over n. This whole term is the variance of S n over n because this is the expectation of S n over n, right. So, this is equal to variance of S n over n, right, which can be written as variance of S n over what? N squared, right. Now, what is variance of S n? See, S n is the sum of the first n x i's, right. Now, these are IID random variables. Since they are independent, you can add their variances to get the variance of S n. So, the variance of S n will be equal to n times the variance of x i, and which is assumed to be finite. Okay. So, this is equal to n times sigma x squared over n squared, correct. So, this n cancels. So, you get sigma x squared over n. Okay. So, this mean squared go as n becomes large goes down to 0 as 1 over n, correct. And so, this goes to 0. Right. Which means that SN over n converges to expectation of x in the mean squared sense, right? And then mean square convergence implies convergence in probability because of Chebyshev's inequality, then you will have convergence in probability. Okay. So, it is really a very simple proof, there are only 3-4 steps to it, right? If you assume finite variance, it is very simple. So, but that is just a partial proof, because this proof only works when the variance of xi is finite, right. You may have a situation where expectation of xi is finite, expectation of x is finite, but the variance is infinite, right. That is possible as we saw, right. Can you think of an example? So, you can think of a PDF or a PMF that goes down like 1 over x cubed, right, that will have finite mean and infinite variance. The law of large numbers does not demand that the variance be finite. So, this proof is not a complete proof. Okay. So, if you want to do a full proof, and the full proof is also easy, but you have to invoke characteristic functions. Okay. So, what we will use is that we will prove that the characteristic function of SN over n, the sequence of random variables SN over n, converges to the characteristic function of this constant random variable, okay. And then I would have proven it, because if I know that the sequence of characteristic function converges to a legitimate characteristic function, then I have convergence in distribution. Now, convergence in distribution is same as convergence in probability if the limit is a constant. So, I would have proved my result, right, that is what I will do now. So, consider the characteristic function of SN over n. Okay. So, I am looking at expectation of e power I t SN over n, excuse me, right, this is what I am looking at. So, this I can write as the expectation of e power I t over n times SN. Correct. Now, the reason I did that, I took the n to the t, is because now this looks like the characteristic function of SN not evaluated at t, but evaluated at t over n. Correct. Now, but what is the characteristic function of SN? See, SN is the sum of these IID random variables. So, I can multiply the characteristic functions. So, it will be the nth power of the Cx of t, correct. So, that is fairly simple. So, this will work out to Cx of, what does it work out to? Cx of, it has to be evaluated at t over n, right, whole raised to n, correct. Fine. Next, since expectation of, so since expectation of x is finite, Cx of t admits a, admits the following expansion. So, you can write Cx of t as 1 plus I expectation of x times t, right, plus little o t, t squared I think, right, little o t or t squared, it is actually I think little o t is, as a matter of fact. It is order t squared terms, right, little o t, right. This is because if the kth moment is finite, you can expand till the kth moment and write a little o term. Right, this is the property, the moment generating property of characteristic functions. Now, so they are excellent. So, you can write this guy as, thus expectation of e power I t S n over n. So, the characteristic function of S n over n is that guy. So, that looks like all this, right. So, 1 plus I expectation of x t over n, right. I am writing t over n instead of t, plus little o of t over n whole raised to n. Okay. Now, as n tends to infinity, what happens to this? So, this little o term looks like it goes to 0 faster than it goes to 0 like t squared or something, t square over n squared, right, the smaller terms. So, as n becomes large, this will become very insignificant, correct. So, for all practical purposes, this will look like 1 plus I expectation of x t over n whole raised to n, right. So, in the limit as n tends to infinity, what happens? This will become e power I. So, this is like 1 plus z over n whole to n, right, which is e power, which goes to e power z as n becomes large, correct. So, this will converge to e power I t expectation of x for all t. Correct. So, this means the characteristic function of the sample average as n becomes large, the characteristic function converges to this is the characteristic function of the constant random variable. If you call this constant c, right, the constant random variable c has characteristic function e power I t c. So, this is the characteristic function of the constant random variable expectation of x. Right, now view expectation of x as a number, not as a number, but a constant random variable, right. So, this will be the characteristic function of the constant random variable expectation of x, which means, so this implies S n over n converges to expectation of x in distribution. That is because we proved a theorem saying convergence of characteristic function to a valid characteristic function implies the convergence of distribution, but now the limit is a constant, right. Convergence in distribution to a constant is same as convergence in probability, right. So, this implies S n over n converges in probability to expectation of x. So, this looks like, so this these terms are terms that are going to 0 faster than t over n. So, there is a t over n term, n is becoming big, right, and these terms are becoming very small. Okay. And so, for all, so you can prove this, you can prove that you know that 1 plus z over n to the n goes to e power z, right, that you know. For every complex z. Now, you have a little bit more, but that little bit more is very small. So, that does not affect this convergence, right. So, this as n tends to infinity, this characteristic function converges to e power I t x. Okay. Any questions? So, here we have not assumed finite variance. The characteristic function proof is a fully general proof, correct? Are there any questions before we move to strong law? So, expectation of x is always a constant, but I am saying that the constant random, let's see, the constant random variable taking value, let's say c, has characteristic function e power itc, right? So I am saying this is the characteristic function of the constant expectation of x. That's all, right? Good. So let's move on to the strong law of large numbers. Again, x i's are iid, expectation of absolute x is less than infinity. You want to prove that SN over N converges to expectation of X almost surely, right? So the proof of the general proof of the strong law is quite long. Okay. So what I will do, so just like here I did two proofs, right? One of them was a partial proof assuming something more. And then here is a completely general proof. So for the strong law, what I will do is I will give you two partial proofs and I will mention how it is extended. Okay. So the first partial proof assumes that the fourth moment of x i's are finite. Okay. So you have, you assume a little more, right? Not even finite variance, but finite fourth moments. Okay. So it so happens that if you assume finite fourth moments of x i's are finite, then you have a very simple proof of strong law. Okay, it's a very elegant proof, it comes out very nicely. But of course, simple fourth moment, it's a fairly strong assumption, right? As assuming that fourth moment is finite. So I'll give you another partial proof that only assumes finite variance. Okay, it's a little bit longer, the second partial proof. You assume only finite variance. And then of course, if you don't even assume finite variance, you have to it's a fairly long proof. Actually, the proof is there in Grimmett, it runs to about 3 pages or so. Okay, it's long but not horribly wrong. It's not 40 pages long, right? As some proofs can be. So I will do two partial proofs. Partial proof: assume expectation of x power 4, x I power 4 is some eta x, okay, some finite number, okay. Also, without loss of generality, assume expectation of x is 0. Actually, the reason I say there is no loss of generality is we can get it back. So, if x i's have some non-zero, so they have finite mean, right? If they have finite fourth moment, they have finite mean. You subtract the means if they have non-zero mean, right? You define x n tilde equal to x n minus expectation of x and then prove the result for x n tilde and then you have to go back to proving it for x. Okay? So this without loss of generality can be justified. Okay? There is no loss of generality in assuming that all these random variables are zero mean. Okay? So what you have, so you have assumed finite fourth moments, so you have, so you will do this. Okay, I think so you will, okay, so let's look at the probability of the fourth power exceeding epsilon. Okay, and so this is less than expectation of correct Markov. Okay. Now I am going to complete, well let me write it this way, SN of absolute SN to the fourth over N to the fourth epsilon to the fourth. Now I am going to compute this guy. Okay. Absolute SN to the fourth is same as SN to the fourth. Oh. Right? This is fine. Okay. So I just took the absolute value out because the fourth power, I mean, it doesn't make a difference, right? Because you're taking the fourth power anyway. So if you look at expectation of Sn to the 4, that will look like expectation of x1 plus dot 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 xn to the 4th. Okay. So, now I am just going to expand this. So, you will get n, so you will get the 4th powers of all the xi's and there will be n such terms, correct. So, this will be equal to n times eta x, it will have, you will have n times eta x as the first x. So, you will have x 1 to the 4th plus x 2 to the 4th plus so on, right, there will be n such terms, correct. Plus what else will you have? You will have terms that looks like x 1, x 2 cubed and so on, correct, or all possible pairs of x I, x j cubed, correct, where I and j run over all indices, correct. Now, what is the expectation of a term like that? What is the expectation of x I, x j cubed? Say they are independent, so you can write it as expectation of x I times expectation of x j cubed, but expectation of x I is 0. So, all these odd terms will go to 0, okay, all these x I, x j cubed terms will go to 0, okay. And what else remains? You will have terms that look like x 1 squared, x 2 squared, right, x I squared, x j squared you will have, right. How many of those do you have? So, you will have, I believe you will have, so you can do n choose 2 of these, right, and then you will have to do 4 choose 2, right. So, you will have something like 6 times n choose 2, so many terms of x 1 squared times x 2 squared, expectation of x 1 squared x 2 squared, correct. So, just x, you are, you have 4 of these, right, write it out. So, you will have expectation of x 1 squared times expectation of x 2 squared, which is nothing but sigma x to the 4th, right, and all other terms will be 0, okay. Just verify this, okay. I am not 100% sure about this, so I think this is correct, but you will essentially, you will get something that looks like n squared times sigma x to the 4th, okay. This is just algebra, there you just expand the whole thing out, and you are making use of the fact that x i's are 0 mean. So, the terms that look like x 2, x, x 3 cubed will go to 0 in expectation, correct. And this comes because you are taking so you are looking at terms like x j, x j squared, x I squared, x j squared, and I and j you can pick in and choose 2 ways, is not it, and there are 4 places where you can pick the I's and j's from, 2 out of 4, right, which is why you get 4 choose 2, which is 6, okay. And then you have expectation of x 1 squared times expectation of x 2 squared, which is sigma x squared times sigma x squared, which is sigma x to the 4th, okay. So, now you have, so this is good. So, expectation of, so if I go back here, okay, so let me put that back here, all right. So, this I will get, so I am going this here, okay. So, this will be equal to what? I have eta x over n cubed epsilon, right, plus 6 times n choose 2 is 3 n n minus 1, right. So, let me just upper bound this as, actually let me just write 3 n squared over n to the 4 epsilon. See, 6 times n choose 2, I have upper bounded by 3 n square, correct. 6 times n choose 2 is nothing but 6 times n time n n minus 1 over 2, which is 3 times n n minus 1, I am upper bounding that by 3 n square, okay. So, great. So, what do I have? So, I have that probability of Sn over n to the fourth exceeding epsilon is less than all that, right. So, I will actually, I will get rid of this. N squared will cancel with n to the fourth to give you n squared epsilon, correct. So, what do you have? So, this implies that sum over n equals 1 through infinity probability of S n over n to the fourth So, if I sum from n to infinity n equal 1 to infinity, what will I get? That will be less than, it will be less than infinity for all epsilon, because this is less than that. And if I sum this from n equal to 1 to infinity, I have a 1 over n cube term and I have a 1 over n square term, they are both finite. As long as I do not have 1 over n, I am fine, I am fine, right. So, this will be less than infinity. So, what does this imply? So, we have seen this, right, by from Borel-Cantelli lemma, we saw if probability of x n minus x greater than epsilon, the summation is finite, then x n goes to x almost surely. This means that S n over n to the fourth goes to 0 almost surely, from which you can show that S n over n goes to 0 almost surely. Okay. So, this implies S n over n to the fourth goes to 0 almost surely, from which you can argue that S n over n goes to 0 almost surely. Okay, this is a very short proof of the strong law. You prove this for 0 mean, now you can put back the mean. You can take these x i's, you can take as x i tilde, which is x I minus expectation of x, right, and then you can prove for non-zero mean also. Okay. Any questions on this? So, from here, how do you conclude that S n over n goes to 0 almost surely? So, the set of all epsilons where, see, set of all omegas where S n over n to the fourth goes to 0, for those omegas S n over n will have to go to 0. Right, so you are saying that the fourth power of a sequence is going to 0, right, which means the sequence has to go to 0. Does go to 0, right. Okay. Actually, you know what? So, I am going to keep this. Okay. So, I was about to erase this, but I am going to use this. So, I will erase this. So, I am going to, if there are no questions on this, I will give you a another partial proof of the strong law of large numbers. This time I will only assume finite variance. So, this assumes something very strong, right, you assume fourth moments are finite, which is a very strong assumption. Okay, now I will do for finite variance. So, once you prove it for finite variance, then you have to, in order to generalize fully, you have to go through a truncation argument. Okay, you have to truncate these random variables at some big value b, and so the truncated random variable will have finite variance, right, and then you have to show that as b is very large, these truncated random variables and your original random variables are close, and then you will get your strong law. Okay. So, partial proof 2. Assume now that sigma x squared is finite, and let expectation of x is equal to mu okay. So, to begin we assume x i's are IID non-negative random variables. So, we will prove strong law for finite variance non-negative random variables okay. Yeah, so in that case, so we know that, so from, so you call this equation star okay, from star we have, so I have a bound on the mean squared right. So, I am going to look for, so I am going to look at this guy okay, S n over n minus mu, mu is my mean by the way, I am going to look for this probability okay. So, this probability is less than by Markov, this is less than sigma x squared over n epsilon, agreed, correct. Why is this? So, this is because this will be less than expectation of that squared over, oh it is epsilon square. So, just a minute. So, I think there should be an epsilon squared here, or if I have so I should probably have epsilon squared here, no, should there be a square here, no, I think there should be a square here, no. So, n, so see all I am saying is I am skipping a step here. So, so this greater than epsilon is same as, yeah, so this squared exceeding that squared right, which means by Markov this is less than expectation of this squared over n times, so the over, sorry, epsilon squared. So, there should be a squared, correct. But I know that expectation of that object squared is sigma x squared over n okay. So, agree with me on this okay. So, all these squares can go away, yeah. So, this you will agree right, this is basically just, actually come to think of it, this is just Chebyshev's inequality right. This is x minus mu greater than epsilon is the less than or equal to epsilon, the variance over epsilon squared correct, and variance is sigma x squared over n, that is all okay. Yeah, correct. So, this is 100% correct okay. So, now this, from this if you take limit n tending to infinity you will get 0 okay, but that will only help you prove convergence in probability right, it does not give you convergence almost surely correct. So, you have to somehow jump from convergence probability to convergence almost surely. See, jumping from convergence almost surely to convergence in probability is trivial right, it always is true, but you know that there is a partial converse going from convergence in probability to convergence almost surely, you recall that if you sum it you will get something that is, so that guy is not going to be finite, that is not going to help you here right, find a subsequence, you find a subsequence. So, What subsequence will you find now? So there are always, see, when you have convergence in probability, there is always a subsequence, a deterministic subsequence that goes to the same limit almost surely, correct? Remember the theorem. And that subsequence is deterministic, it does not depend on omega, right. So I think I mentioned, see, you have these occasional epsilon excursions in this convergence in probability, but by choosing the subsequence you are able to avoid these excursions, right. So the nice thing is you can choose the subsequence irrespective of the realization. See, I mean, if your subsequence can depend on the realization, it is no big deal, right. I can avoid precisely those excursions, right. That is not surprising at all, but I can choose a subsequence which avoids deterministically beforehand, before even omega realizes, so that I do not have these epsilon excursions and therefore I have convergence almost surely. So if you consider here, so what do you think should be the sequence? There should be a subsequence of this n. If you go like k squared, if n k, let n k equal to k squared. So the reason I am doing k squared is I want this to go to 0 faster now. Actually I do not need k square, I can even take k to the 1 plus delta, but this is fine. So I am not looking at S 2 over 2, S 3 over 3, S 4 over 4 and so on, I am looking at for the perfect squares, right, k equal to n equal to some perfect square, I am looking at that sequence. Then what happens is probability of S n k over n k minus mu, if you just look at that, will be less than sigma x squared over n k epsilon squared, right, and n k is equal to k squared. So that will be k squared epsilon squared. Okay. So if I sum this over k now, so this is a subsequence n k, right, index by k. Now if I sum this over k, I get something that is something finite, right, which means the sequence S n k index by k, S n k over n k index by k goes to 0, goes to mu almost surely, correct. So if you have thus sum over k equal to 1 to infinity, probability of S n k over n k minus mu greater than epsilon is finite, because if you sum this over k equal to 1 to infinity, you get something finite, right, for all epsilon. This means S n k over n k goes to mu almost surely as k goes to infinity. Okay. So this is not all that surprising, because if you know that S n over n goes to mu in probability, so there must be sums subsequence S n k over n k which goes to 0, goes to mu almost surely by the theorem, right. The good thing is we have identified what that n k is, it is k squared is enough, right. So that is good. Now can I actually, now that is not enough, right. I have to prove that S n over n goes to mu almost surely. Now that is where this assumption comes in. So this non-negative assumption is going to help us now. Okay. So what happens if, so next if you consider, so you are looking at S n over n, if k n is a perfect square, this helps you, right? Whenever n is a perfect square, those terms go to 0 almost surely. But what if n is not a perfect square, right? So, in that case you have to prove. So, you have to look at, so let us say if n is some 13 or something, look at the number which is the perfect square which is smaller and the next number which is bigger, next perfect square which is bigger. So, you can write this, is not it? S n will lie between, so since x i's are non-negative, S n can be bounded between S so let me write it like this, S k plus 1 squared and S k squared, where k squared is less than or equal to n is less than or equal to k plus 1 squared. So, if n is not a perfect square, you find the next smallest and the next biggest perfect squares. Okay. Well, maybe you should have that less than. Okay. You can always do that. And why is this true? Because your x i's are non-negative. So, these s i's can only increase, correct? So, this you will agree with. Now, ideally I want, so I want some sandwiching argument to go through, right. So, I am going to divide this by n, which is what I want, right. Now, what should I divide this by in order to preserve this inequality? So, okay, let me just divide all of this by n, that is definitely fine, right. So, I should write that as S k plus 1 squared over n, right. I am just dividing everything by n, then I can write one more term. So, I can write this is less than or equal to S k squared over, so I have to divide by something larger. So, I can do, I cannot do k squared, right, then this inequality would not hold, right. Then here I have to do a similar trick. So, I have S k plus 1 squared over, now what do I do? Instead of n I write, I cannot write k plus 1 squared, so I write k squared, okay. So, you agree with that, right, this is just algebra. Now I send n to infinity, okay. If I send n to infinity, k also goes to infinity, right. So, k goes to infinity, what happens to this term? See, I know that x k squared over k squared goes to mu almost surely, which means x k squared over k plus 1 squared also goes to mu almost surely. You see why? Well, because it is again just simple algebra, right. So, I send, take n to infinity. So, then you will have, so as n tends to infinity, k will also go to infinity. So, limit k tends to infinity S k squared over k plus 1 squared less than or equal to limit n tending to infinity S n over n is less than or equal to limit k tending to infinity S k plus 1 squared over k squared. So, I have a sandwiching argument coming up, right. So, this as k tends to infinity. So, this guy can be written as S k squared over k squared times k squared over k plus 1 squared, correct. So, limit k tending to infinity of that, correct. But as limit k tends to infinity, the almost sure limit of this is mu, and as k tends to infinity that goes to 1, that deterministically goes to 1, right. So, the limit of this as k tends to infinity is almost surely equal to mu, right. So, this is this limit is almost surely equal to mu, correct. And similarly, this is all this is also almost surely equal to mu. So, therefore, this limit exists almost surely, see, right, because this guy is this limit is sandwiched between two objects which are almost surely converging to mu, right. So, this limit exists almost surely and that limit is equal to mu almost surely, right. So, that is the sandwich argument, ok. So, S n over n goes to 0 or goes to mu almost surely. We have assumed finite variants and we have also assumed non-negative random variables, right. So, to extend to possibly negative random variables with finite variants, write x I is equal to x I plus minus x I minus and proceed, ok. So, the same trick, I write x is equal to x plus minus x minus, and so you can get rid of the non-negative assumption, ok. So, for finite variance random variables we have more or less we have actually proved the strong law of large numbers. So, in order to remove this finite variance assumption as well, you have to, as I said, you have to do a truncation argument. You have to define x I tilde equal to max of b comma x I, right. So, you truncate these random variables x I, when they take very large values greater than b, some b, you call it equal to b, ok. Now, these truncated random variables will have finite variance, so the law will go through, right. And then you have to make sure that this b goes to infinity at an appropriate rate, ok. So, that is where the difficulty is, that is it is not very conceptually very demanding, it is just messy, ok. Actually, Grimmett has a full proof of without any further assumptions it has a proof, and also Terry Tauf's blog has a very nice exposition on the strong law of large numbers, you know, the famous mathematician Terry Tauf, his blog has a very good article blog on strong law of large numbers, ok, you can read, ok. I will stop here.